As many of you know, we recently did a story on OneWest purchase of IndyMac's assets from the FDIC, in which we highlighted how we believe this transaction was a sweetheart deal and that it was bad for the taxpayers, which, by the way, is still our unwavering belief.
That's right. But the premise of our story seems to be getting clouded by the FDIC's accusation of inaccuracies in the video. And we feel they're more errors of semantics about non-relevant points. So to try and keep the focus on the real questions we're raising, we've attempted to make some corrections to the video.
Now, we don't want to be accused of hiding anything, so the original uncorrected video is posted right over here. We've also started posting links to other articles and sources of information regarding this issue, so you can examine the evidence and draw your own conclusions, and we'll continue to post anything as long as it appears relevant to the story.
Right. So keep reading the discussion down below and checking back. With that, here's the updated story questioning these practices, which we still hope you'll take to heart and forward to everyone that you know.
Now, do you think that every decision being made by various government organizations is really in the best interest of our economic recovery? Consider this. Like many other banks, IndyMac closed its doors and was seized by the FDIC in July 2008. The assets of IndyMac Bank were sold to OneWest Bank by the FDIC in March 2009. All current residential mortgages were purchased at 70% of the par value. All HELOCs were purchased at 58% of the value. But just to make sure the OneWest guys are feeling all cozy and warm, the FDIC decided to step up and cover between 80 and 95% of the losses they might incur from any of those naughty IndyMac mortgage homeowners. So you're probably asking yourself why we think that you should know this.
Well, in the event of a short sale or a foreclosure, the loss is calculated using the original loan balance and not the amount OneWest Bank paid for the loan. I feel the plot thickening here a little bit, don't you? Here's an actual example from a client of one of our TVWS viewers. Now make sure to listen closely because this is going to get your blood boiling.
Take an actual loan amount of $478,000 plus 6 months of missed payments for a grand total of $485,200. OneWest Bank paid $334,600 for that loan. Okay, now the underwater homeowner has an all-cash offer that nets $241,000 to OneWest Bank. Stick with us now.
Well, according to the FDIC formula, you take the original loan amount minus the amount of the offer, and that leaves you with $244,200.
Next, according to the sweetheart deal, the FDIC writes a check to OneWest Bank for 80% of the net loss. So according to their loss share agreement, OneWest Bank would be eligible to receive $195,360 in loss reimbursement, even though they only lost $93,600.
Okay, so now add the $195,360 from the government to the $241,000 cash offer, and OneWest Bank just made $436,360 on a loan that they bought for only $334,600, and all they had to do is sell it for whatever they wanted. Guys, how can they lose?
So OneWest Bank is in a position to profit from the short sale to the tune of $101,760, all thanks to the insane arrangement that they have with the FDIC. Hey, whoever said it's not good to have friends in high places?
So the next time you ask yourself, why is it so hard to get a loan modification? The answer is because there's too much money to be made with short sales and foreclosures. Now, are you ready for an encore?
Now remember, even though OneWest Bank stands to profit by over $100,000, the house was still sold for less than the full amount. In this actual scenario, the borrower was asked to sign a promissory note for $75,000 with OneWest Bank. So who really pays in the end? That's up for you to figure out.
Oh, and by the way, we have to be fair and point out that OneWest loss share agreement stipulates that they aren't eligible to receive any of the benefits we just highlighted unless their total losses exceed $2.5 billion. So, on top of everything we just highlighted, this arrangement provides what appears to be massive incentive to generate multi-billion dollar losses as well. Hey, with pressure from governmental mistakes like HVCC and arrangements like this one driving down our home home prices, we don't see how the real estate market will ever recover. And if the real estate market doesn't recover, well, then the overall economy will never be able to make any recovery as well. Well, there you go. Thanks for watching. And if you'd like us to stay in touch with you, you can do so by subscribing for free by clicking down below.
And if you like our videos, forward them. Forward them to somebody else in the industry. It helps us out. Thanks a lot, guys. See you later.